Peter Gibbons worked as a computer programmer at Inatech, and he did not like his job. Well, let's be frank, he truly hated it. More than that, he despised his management. Well, he reported to 8 different bosses. 8 bosses. And this misery at the office trickled into his home. And his romantic relationship began to unravel. So the desperate times called for desperate measures, and Peter Gibbons, he signed up for a hypnotherapy session. The session went terribly wrong. It was a disaster. The pent-up frustration that Peter brought into the doctor's office was too much for the hypnotist to take in. Dr. Swanson collapsed in front of Peter's eyes. He suffered a heart attack. He dropped dead. Wow, that was a cathartic experience for Peter. But it was also a liberating one. He finally understood now was the time to take control of his life. He was no longer prepared to tolerate the suppression of the office. Oh, there's a lot of drama in this story. Somebody should have made a movie out of it, no? Well, somebody did. The film Office Space came out in the year 1999, and Peter Gibbons, he spoke for his generation when he said this: "It's not that I'm lazy, it's that I just don't care." For some reason, you don't look surprised. Well, let me say that again. It's not that I'm lazy, it's that I just don't care. Peter Gibbons, he's a fictional character. You and I, we're real, and we want to care. We want our jobs to have meaning. We want to make a real difference. So what is holding us back? It's the ideas. It's the ideas and the vocabulary that we've inherited from the industrial age. It's the hierarchy, the bureaucracy, the command and control logic of running a business. All of those ideas, they have outlived themselves. But we're sticking with them for some reason. They made a lot of sense in the time of factories and assembly lines. But now we live in the world of open offices, unicorns, remote work. Why are we sticking with those ideas? We have nobody to blame but ourselves. Ourselves and the dictionary. The dictionary is where the ideas reside. The status quo gets entrenched in the language that we use. Let's take the term manager. It was the bane of Peter's existence, but it's a linchpin of a hierarchy too. Have you heard the saying that employees, they join companies, but when they leave their managers? And you know, quick Google search can tell you why. My manager is rude, he's treating me unfairly, and a control freak. Wow, that is seriously depressing. But blaming the manager is not a solution. They're the victims of the same outdated system. And to be fair, the managers I've encountered in my life, they were great. They were really good at their jobs, they were competent people. But in a system that expects the managers to command and control, do you know what managers will do? They'll do exactly that, they'll command and control. Well, some of us do behave like toddlers at the office. And it's this walking rope could be a handy tool. But broadly speaking, the world has changed quite a lot since the time of the steam engine 2.5 centuries ago. There are a few megatrends which are really putting traditional organizational models under serious strain. Number one trend that we should discuss is that drives everything else. It's the accelerated pace of technology. Everyone at this conference is talking about it. Raise your hand if you remember the world before social media. Anyone? Yeah? How about the world before smartphones? Keep your hand up if you do. Okay, the world before the internet. Fewer people, okay. How about the world before computers? Okay, wow, more than half. The first time I sat in front of a computer, it was the year 1994, it was a magical experience. Every one of those inventions I mentioned, they turned the world upside down. But guess what? So did the abacus and the printing press. The big difference is it took 2,000 years for those milestones, and we've experienced a handful in our lifetimes. This megatrend renders the idea of forecasting obsolete. We can no longer credibly project the future 10, 20, 30 years forward. And when we cannot forecast, where does it leave strategy? Strategy is forecasting, planning, and implementing. And managers, they earn their keep by formulating the strategy and then implementing it. So if the strategy is gone for good, where does it leave the managers? Another megatrend we should talk about is the automation of everything. You have all heard the forecasts that 2 billion jobs could be disappearing within a decade. Okay, let's make it relevant. Everyone on my left, by year 2030, you are all unemployed if this forecast comes true. And some of you on my right are probably wondering, if in the year 2030 I have to report to 8 different managers, maybe I should have picked a different seat. But this was just a forecast. 2 billion jobs disappearing, it's half of the jobs that exist today. And we know forecasting doesn't make any sense anymore. But what is certain, what the consensus view is tasks that could be parsed out, they'll be automated. And the creative work, the work that requires intuition, collaboration across teams, that work will remain, but it doesn't lend itself naturally to management. What else is happening in the world is the millennials, they will soon dominate the workplace. They got their priorities right. They will not join your firm until you got a ping pong table, right? But what makes this generation different from everybody else? They grew up digital. They understand networks a lot better than they understand hierarchies. The information is power, we all know that. And the managers, when they see information, they hoard it. And what do millennials do? Their first instinct is to share it. To share it and to become an influencer, become a hub and a network. That's a new kind of power. And do you think the hierarchy can survive this megatrend? Well, there are 3 signs that are literally pushing the traditional manager out of the door. It's the accelerated pace of change, automation of everything, and the millennials coming of age. And some companies, they're really struggling to cope. They either don't understand what's going on or they don't know what to do. Other companies out there, they take half measures, and half measures is even worse. They bring their managers together and say, empower your teams, engage with your customers, and then they don't change the organizational design. And what you end up with? Confusion, apathy, and distrust. But there is a 3rd group of companies which are thriving. Steve Jobs sensed the zeitgeist well before many others. And his wisdom can be summed up in this one quote. It doesn't make sense to hire smart people and then tell them what to do. Instead, we hire smart people so they tell us what to do. And this logic, it worked out really well for Apple. Became the first public company to reach a $1 trillion valuation. And $1 trillion is more than GDP of most countries, including the Netherlands where I live. Another company to look at is CRISP. There's no CEO, no one's in charge. Okay, let me take that back. Everyone's in charge. Everyone's stepping up, taking responsibility, making decisions at their level. That happens to be one and only level in the organization. This design is now called holacracy, and more businesses are experimenting with it. Authority and decision-making are distributed throughout the whole organization, and they're not vested in the management hierarchy. So it does not operate on the reporting lines, it operates on a set of principles. And if you believe something needs to be done, you step up and do it. Assemble a team around you and move the company forward as long as it serves the mission. Okay, enough about tech. Let's talk about good old manufacturing. What does the refrigerator and YouTube have in common? Well, quite a lot if the fridge is made by the company Hire. It's the biggest appliance maker based in China. And just like YouTube, it set itself up as a platform. It doesn't source its content from internal monopolies, you know, monopoly on legal services, on marketing, on product. Instead, it operates as 4,000 micro-enterprises. Each one is about a dozen people. They compete and collaborate every which way. The CEO understands the importance of making decisions where the customers are. And this company was able to achieve something remarkable. They cut the time from concept to product by 70%. This organizational design inspired a brand new term, humanocracy. And at Hire, there's not a lot of space for managers. There's plenty of space for entrepreneurs. So can we now say that the era of management is over? Well, let's not get carried away. Tech companies, they get a lot of publicity. But those unicorns, they remain a tiny fraction of global economy, an even smaller fraction of employment. The global workforce comprises of 3.5 billion people, and majority of jobs, they don't require creativity and spontaneity, they require efficiency and consistency. And the bureaucracy we talked about, it could be soul-crushing, but it works. It delivers efficiency at scale. A flat structure, it could be interesting on paper, but it could be disorienting. Companies that tried holacracy, they admit that it was a difficult thing to implement because we humans are status-obsessed creatures. And how do you broadcast your status in a company that has no official titles? How do you even know what your status is? One other reason that plays for the management is our human nature, our relationship with authority. Sometimes we really like to defer decisions. We want our managers to make them for us. So in that sense, we're vested in the hierarchy, even if we resent it. But what has always been true and remains true is that bureaucracy comes with a cost. Peter Gibbons, he was a talented programmer and he wasn't lazy, but he could only master 15 minutes of real, actual work in a given week. Well, we in this room can do a lot better. Should we say an hour, hour and a half on a good day? Yeah? What are we doing the rest of the time? We're ticking boxes, we're pushing papers, we're waiting for those decisions to come down. So we're busy doing things that are not adding that much value. But we could all contribute a lot more. We have many talents. And companies where we work, believe it or not, they recognize it. They want the exact same thing. They want to give us the space to make a real contribution. They simply don't know how. And this is clearly a lose-lose situation, and those things do not last. We live in the age of disruption. iPhone, when it came out, almost disrupted Nokia out of business. Netflix today is shaking the movie industry to its core. And tomorrow's wave of disruption is no longer about products and services. It will be coming for organizational designs. Do you think our business vocabulary can survive those tectonic shifts? I really hope not. Managers, they manage. Directors, they direct. Supervisors, they supervise. And what do executives do? They execute. Well, let's not go that far. Every one of those terms, they symbolize command and control. But what really matters today is the context in which the businesses or teams operate. Let me give you an example. If you were a CEO of a car company a few decades ago, to compete, what you had to do is make better cars, faster cars, cheaper cars. Context did not matter that much if you were an automaker. Today, if you're a car company, are you hardware or software? Are you supposed to make better cars and marketed to individual customers? Are you supposed to plan for self-driving ecosystem based on a subscription model? Context is everything, it keeps shifting. We all know that data is a new oil, and oil has this faculty, it flows. And so does the data. Data is not static. Every business now collects the data. We want to be ready for the digital age. And this data helps us define context at this very moment. But then the data flows, context shifts. So to lead a team is not to assign tasks and monitor performance. It's to understand the context, to interpret it for your team members, to curate it. We've invented a couple of terms, to offer an alternative to hierarchy? Why don't we have an alternative to a manager? I say we retire this term altogether and we hire context curators in their stead. And that brings us to a duck test. Swims like a duck and walks like a duck must be a duck. And this logic works both ways. If you call something a duck, it will swim, quack, and look like one. So when we're thinking of managers, if we don't retire this terminology, the managers will default to traditional managerial behavior. But we know that the pace of change renders strategy obsolete, and we need to move to experimentation and rapid iteration. When the automation of everything leaves there nothing to command and control, the context curators will be better positioned to empower and mentor. And when the millennials dominate the workplace, the rigid hierarchy will have to yield to flexible networks. The term manager entered English vocabulary 4 centuries ago. And it comes from a Latin word, manus. Has to do with the hand, with handling things. Curator, on the other hand, has to do with caring and helping. And do you remember who had troubles caring for his job? Peter Gibbons, who reported to 8 different managers. If only did he work in a team that was led by a context curator. Well, let me leave you with this thought. Is the era of management over? I really don't know. But I sure hope that the era of the context curator is about to dawn. Thank you.